The greatest of prophets, Islam was his only goal. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From among all the prophets, Muhammad was the last, as his was a mission of the greatest task. There was only moral degeneration. People clung to idol adoration. For all nations he...
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, may Allah be pleased with him, as we've mentioned this before, was the first to accept the da'wah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He was the first to embrace Islam and to believe in the message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam. And that is why Allah, the Almighty, has described Abu Bakr and those who were with him with the following verse, which translates to, and the foremost to embrace Islam of the Muhajireen and Ansar, those who followed them exactly in faith, Allah is well pleased with them and they are well pleased with him. He has prepared for them gardens under which rivers flow, that is in paradise, to dwell therein forever, that is the supreme success. And by far that is the supreme success. So those who were foremost to embrace Islam among the Muhajireen, those who migrated, and among the Ansar, those who were living in Medina and supported the Prophet ﷺ and those who came with him, and those who followed them exactly in faith, and we supplicate to Allah and we hope from Allah that we would be among those who followed them in faith. Allah Azza wa Jal is well pleased with them and they are well pleased with Him. Now, if you hear of someone talking badly about Abu Bakr, about Umar, about Uthman, or about Ali, may Allah be pleased with them all, or any of the companions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, this is a clear sign that this person is a hypocrite, and the biggest possibility is that he's not a Muslim, though he claims to be a Muslim. Because talking badly about Abu Bakr means that this person is doubting Islam. He's doubting Allah's judgment. He's doubting the judgment of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, who took Abu Bakr to be his closest friend. And those who talk negatively about Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, they are claiming that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was fooled by Abu Bakr, and that Abu Bakr managed to cheat the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. They are not Muslims. Whoever talks about Abu Bakr or about Aisha, they are not Muslims if they talk about them negatively, even if they pray and fast, because they are the keepers, they are the defenders of Islam, and it is not accepted at all to talk about them negatively. Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, was a man of humbleness. He was down to earth. He would never accept anyone to look at him as an arrogant person or to think of him other than what he really is. And he was always afraid to be someone he is not. And that is why he was striving his best to be in accordance to what pleases Allah Azza wa Jal. And definitely he had pleased Allah the Almighty. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once said that Allah does not look at a person who drags his thawb, who drags his garment, who drags his trousers, who drags whatever he's wearing on the floor out of pride. out of arrogance. Now, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام is talking about a person who prolongs his dress, whether it's trousers, it's a thobe, it's any garment that he wears on his body that exceeds his ankles. This is a sin by itself. And it is a greater sin if a person does this out of arrogance and pride, because he doesn't want to be like everyone else. So Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, stood out in fear and said, O Prophet of Allah, am I one of them? In another narration, Abu Bakr said, O Prophet of Allah, my garment is loose and I am a thinny and skinny person. I'm thin and I'm skinny. So every time I try to wrap it, it gets loose and it goes beyond or below my ankles. So am I one of them? And the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام gave him a declaration, gave him a certificate of humbleness and said, Abu Bakr, you are not one of them. And the funny thing is, a lot of people nowadays prolong their trousers below the ankles or the thobes. And when we advise them, oh brother, this is not allowed, you have to raise it a little bit, shorten it a little bit. He says, well, I'm like Abu Bakr. I'm not doing this out of pride. And this is a misconception, because Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, was giving the certificate from the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, who Allah revealed to him that Abu Bakr is not one of them. But you, who gave you the certificate? It's your devil, it's your whims. So you have to comply, you have to follow the instructions of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, he used to do things that we humans think to be impossible. Imagine this situation. There was an incident that was mentioned in Surah An-Nur, where a group of hypocrites slandered our mother, Aisha bint Abi Bakr, the daughter of Abu Bakr, who is the wife of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, and all the wives of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام are our mothers. So these group of hypocrites managed to talk negatively, badly about Aisha when she, may Allah be pleased with her, in one of the journeys of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, lost her necklace and spent time looking for it while the army was already ahead of her. So she was lost. She stayed in her position. There was a man who was supposed to look for lost people and to see if anyone lost something, he would retrieve it. And his name was Safwan ibn Mu'attal. May Allah be pleased with him. He saw her and he recognized her because he used to see her before the hijab was mandated. So immediately he said in a loud voice, Astaghfirullah, and turned his face. And she got on the camel and he took her to the army. And it was about 3 or 4 hours until they reached the outskirts of Medina. And the minute the hypocrite saw Safwan ibn Mu'attal, may Allah be pleased with him, with Aisha, they started gossiping and talking negatively. This by far is unimaginable. But this is what happened. And subhanAllah, among those who spoke were three of the companions of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Hassan ibn Thabit, the poet of the Prophet, Hamnah bin Jahsh, the cousin of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, and his sister-in-law, because her sister is Zainab bin Jahsh, the wife of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, and Mustah ibn Athatha, may Allah be pleased with them all. And who is Mustah? This is inshallah what we will know after the break, so stay tuned.
Among all the prophets, Muhammad was the last.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah and welcome back. Mustah ibn Athatha was the cousin of Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him. He was the cousin of Abu Bakr. And he was among the first to migrate to Medina. So he falls under the category of and the foremost to embrace Islam of the Muhajirin and the Ansar and also those who followed them exactly in faith. Allah is well pleased with them and they are well pleased with him. So Mustah ibn Athatha was a companion, but he was a poor one, extremely poor to the extent that he used to live in the masjid. And whatever people got something to give as charity, they would give it to Ahl al-Suffa, those 70 or 80 men who had nowhere to live and had nothing to pay or to give. And they lived in the masjid. Abu Bakr, being a businessman, he used to give him a monthly allowance. Being his cousin and also being one of the early to emigrate to Medina. But when this incident of ifk, this incident of lie and slander took place, the hypocrites managed to have Mustah, Hamna ibn Jahsh, and Hassan ibn Thabit, may Allah be pleased with them all, talk and gossip in this great sin and crime. And the minute Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, heard this, he was outraged. He was so angry, he swore by Allah that I would never pay him anything because of what he said about my daughter. And that would be extremely normal because he not only slandered his cousin's daughter, he also slandered the mother of the believers, the wife of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And unfortunately, there are people who claim to be Muslims. They slander Aisha every day and night. May Allah be pleased with her. And this is blasphemy because it was Allah who instructed and ordered his Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam to marry Aisha. Jibreel, peace be upon him, the archangel Jibreel, came to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam with her photo and he told him that this is your wife in this life and in the hereafter. Twice he brought him her image and he instructed him to marry her. So anyone talking negatively about her is doubting Allah's judgment, as if Allah Azza wa Jal is cheating his Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, God forbid, and astaghfirullah from saying such a thing. But those who slandered her, who talk negatively about her, are saying exactly this. So Abu Bakr did the normal thing any one of us would do. And up till here, it's normal. The wahi, the revelation, was postponed on giving the verdict on such an incident. Some say it took 1 month, and the Prophet ﷺ did not know what to do. He believes in the innocence of his wife, his beloved wife, the most beloved person on earth to his heart. Yet, he's unable to say or do anything because he does not have concrete proof. And after a whole month, Allah Azza wa Jal revealed her innocence in beautiful verses in Surah An-Nur. All Muslims recite it, believe in it, and understand it. Any Muslim who believes otherwise is not a Muslim. He is a kafir. He is a disbeliever who still insists on slandering Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, is not a Muslim. And if he dies, he should not be buried with the Muslims in Muslims' cemeteries. Anyhow, Allah Azza wa Jal also revealed these beautiful verses so that Abu Bakr would forgive and pardon. And that is why the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam went to Abu Bakr and said, Abu Bakr, did you hear what Allah Azza wa Jal said in your affair? And he recited the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and let not those among you who are blessed with grace and wealth swear not to give any sort of help to their kinsmen, al-masakeen, the poor, and those who left their homes for Allah's cause. Let them pardon and forgive. Do you not love that Allah should forgive you? And Allah is of forgiven, most merciful. So the Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, فَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَنْ يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. He said, Abu Bakr, Allah says, let them pardon and forgive. Don't you want Allah to forgive you? This is the verse. Now, with all this hatred, with all this anguish, with all this anger in my heart towards this person who said and did what he did to my daughter, to my blood and flesh, I wouldn't pardon, I wouldn't forgive, but not Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him. That is why there is a huge gap between us and him, may Allah be pleased with him. He immediately said to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, O Prophet of Allah, I do want Allah to forgive me and to pardon me, and I swear by Allah that I will never ever cut my allowance to him. I will continue to give him this allowance till the day I die. This was Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him. Things that may seem to be inhuman, Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, took this beautiful attribute and characteristic from the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, who used to pardon people. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم had so many stories about pardoning and forgiving people that it is beyond imagination. Yet he was sent as a mercy to mankind صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. And if you read his seerah, his biography, you learn and you understand why Allah Azza wa Jal chose him صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, did not want this life. He was not having his roots deep in the earth. He was only anticipating the day he would leave and join the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. So he did not care about what he dressed with or what he rides or how his house would look. He just simply wanted to have good deeds and to refrain from bad deeds. This is exactly what he wanted. May Allah be pleased with him. And that is why the minute he was chosen as a khalifa, a successor to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, the following day he left his house heading to the market so that he could buy and sell and be able to provide his family. Now, when the companions saw him, the head of the state, going to the market to buy and sell, they told him, where are you going to? He said, I'm going to the market. They told him, don't. He said, what do you mean, don't? I have to provide my family. I have to work. They told him, we will give you what you need. And they gave him an allowance, sort of a salary, so that he could provide his family. He did not use his position to live in a mansion. He did not use his position to buy cars or to buy airplanes or to give lands to his kinsmen and to his relatives. He did not use any of this. He lived in his house, his small room, and be with what he was doing. But Al-Hasan ibn Ali, may Allah be pleased with him and with his father, he is telling us that when Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, was dying, while he was on his dying bed, he instructed Aisha, his daughter, may Allah be pleased with her, and told her, Aisha, we have a small goat that we drink of her milk, and we have a small pot where we put this milk in, and we have sort of a piece of cloth that we cover ourselves with and pray on. I instruct you to take all of this and give it to Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, so that people, the Muslims, would benefit from these three things. Now imagine, this is all what he possessed in this life, and that is why It was said that when he died, he did not leave one single dirham nor a single dinar. He was not like most of the kings and the presidents who would gather and collect the money for this life, thinking as they will never die. He did not leave a thing. So when Aisha instructed these three things to be taken to Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, Umar cried and wept and said, may Allah forgive you, Abu Bakr. You have made life difficult to anyone who succeeds you. And his companions told him, well, if this is the case, then after the death of Abu Bakr, take these three things and give them back to his family. He said, by Allah, I would not cheat him after his death. He gives it in his life and I take it back and give it to his family? No, but my money is their money and his children are my children. I'll take care of them as my own. Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, as he was dying, they brought him the sheets that they wrap the dead people with before they bury them. And he looked at it and said, these are new, and the dead do not need new clothes. Take this and give it to someone who would make use of it. Wrap me in my thobes, in my dress, and buy one that is old and wrap it around me when I die, because this will be buried and there is no need for using it or utilizing it. Abu Bakr did not want this life, and this life did not want him, because he was the companion of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He never ate something that was unlawful. It was reported once that he was fasting and his servant came with food to break his fast on. And usually he asks him, where did you get this food from? That day he was hungry, he took a bite and swallowed it and then remembered and said to his boy, where did you get this food from? And the boy said, about 15 years ago, I met some Arabs and I pretended to be a priest telling the future. So I said something to them and they gave me this food now, after we all embraced Islam and we forgot all of this. So the food originally is not forbidden, but because of the fear that Abu Bakr had in his heart, he thought that this food is not lawful for him to eat, because the source was fortune telling. So he put his finger in his mouth, trying to vomit this one small bite that he ate after 15 hours of fasting. And when he could not, he tried his best until it came out. And they told him, may Allah forgive you, you almost killed yourself with this. He said, by Allah, had it not come out without my soul coming out with it, I would have accepted that I would die so that this bite would not be in my stomach, because I've heard the Prophet ﷺ saying that any meat, any flesh that grows out of haram, it will be ended in the hell fire. Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, died in Jamad al-Ula on the 13th year of Al-Hijrah, leaving bright pages in our history. May Allah be pleased with him, and may Allah Azza wa Jal gather us with him on the Day of Judgment in Paradise with our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is all the time we have. Until we meet next time, fi amanillah. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.